Mr. Schubert, good morning.
Good morning, Your Honor. May it please the Court, I'm Attorney Greg Schubert, representing Damone Cannon in this issue. If Your Honor's please, relative to the brief that I filed in this particular case, it's clear the mistakes that I attribute to counsel. But I'm happy to say, as my brother in his previous argument pointed out, it's too often that we come here alleging ineffective assistance of counsel. That's not the case that happened in this particular case. That's not what I'm here to point out to this particular court. I am saying that the mistakes of counsel were minuscule in relationship to the mistakes made by the trial judge. The trial judge in this particular case is another example that capital crimes team's counsel cannot be continually sent to do an impossible mission. The trial judge knew the facts in this case. The facts in this case are as follows. The only witness against Mr. Cannon of any validity whatsoever is Ms. Murphy, the live-in girlfriend, wife, whatever you wish to call her, of the deceased hacker. She was in bed, she really saw nothing. But what we do know is, on the stand, she admits she's a liar.
Well, what, can you clarify? You say she saw nothing. We know she heard a voice. I thought she went into the room after the shooting and saw the defendant.
Well, that's the story that we come up with, Your Honor, after, okay? We realize first that, hello, we didn't hear something, we did hear something.
Well,
right?
You say she saw nothing.
Well, if you believe the second testimony, what I'm saying to you, Judge, when the trial judge...
But there wasn't first testimony. The only testimony was that she saw something. There was first a statement to the police or whatever.
Correct.
But there wasn't first testimony.
That is correct. And what I'm pointing out to the court is we were dealing with a witness who, by her own admission, removes the gun of the deceased person. She hides the gun of the deceased person. We are dealing with a witness who, by her own testimony, admits, I took the money, I hid the money. She had her own agenda. If you believe her story, I was merely acting because...
Well, wasn't all of them before the jury, and didn't they know, and wasn't it up to them to decide whether to believe her testimony that she saw the defendant or not?
That may well be the case, but I'm getting to the point that I'd like to make about the fact that the court, aware of the fact that there was no forensic evidence that really connected Mr. Cannon, there was no evidence other than Ms. Murphy, and we agree that Ms. Murphy is an acknowledged liar who told a whole bunch of different stories and did a bunch of things that helped Ms. Murphy but did not help anyone other than Ms. Murphy. And then she came to the bosom of the police and came up with a story which was able to be told to a jury and accepted. The trial judge knew this. And it brings me to my next point.
Hector, well, you haven't made a point.
The trial judge
what is
done?
The first point?
Yeah. The point is knowing this, the trial judge knows that this case is really a lousy case for the Commonwealth.
So what is the judge supposed to do?
Well, the judge is not supposed to take the side of the Commonwealth. And I suggest to you that is exactly what the judge did in this case when we got to the shotgun. Now, we know that Hecker was shot with a .38. We know.
Was he convicted of possessing the shotgun?
Yeah. Well, did they find him not guilty?
A very good point, Judge. Not even the jury would believe the connection between the defendant and the shotgun. And yet, to make the case better for the Commonwealth, the judge says, this is possible that this was used in the robbery. And let me be very blunt about this. In my brief, the most important sentence in the entire brief is, there was never an armed robbery, and there was never any facts that one could assume or even pretend is consistent with an attempted armed robbery. The facts are in this case.
What about the slang word that they used? I forget, roll them or whatever.
Run them.
To the extent there was testimony, said that that means rob him. How can you say that there was no evidence of an attempted armed robbery? I would suggest that's evidence of an attempted armed robbery. You may not believe it, but it's evidence.
Well, run them is at odds as to what it really means. And the second.
No, but there was testimony, which is evidence, which the jury may or may not credit, that run them means rob them.
But what I'm suggesting to you, Judge, is that if you even buy the run them means rob them.
Well, what do you think run them could mean? Kill them? Rob them? I mean, what else could it
mean? Well, first
of
all, we don't actually know who said it.
Well, what difference does
it make? No, but it was one of the joint ventures.
Oh, it makes a big difference
because
it was
one of the three people that was there. The jury obviously believed it was said. They apparently believed what it meant. And then there was evidence of the three gunshots, and they put that all together and said, gee, it seems reasonable that this was at least an attempted armed robbery.
Judge, it is every bit as possible. And that's the real thing that bothers me here, is the Webster-type language that the trial judge used, that it's possible that this gun should be introduced, the shotgun, when it's just as possible that the Sig Hauer that was owned by the deceased was drawn by the deceased when the people that were in his apartment didn't want to pay for the drugs. We have absolutely no idea what actually happened out there. Run them could have even been
said. Are you suggesting a self-defense?
I'm suggesting that is every bit as possible.
But was there any evidence of self? I mean, did the defense introduce any self-defense evidence?
No. The defense did not. It would not have been propitious for the defense to do that because the case of the Commonwealth was so incredibly weak. And so it was shored up by the trial court.
Well, his defense was he wasn't there.
That is correct. And that would mean that we certainly wouldn't want to say that we were there.
And you wouldn't argue self-defense. Self-defense is inconsistent with the defense in this case.
But what I'm saying is, Judge, it is every bit as possible. And
no, it isn't every bit as possible. There was no evidence of self-defense.
If, in fact, the defendant had decided to put on a defense of self-defense, that would be one thing. His lawyer and he made a decision relative to the defense that would be offered, Judge. I'm not questioning that. What I am saying to you is, sir, that under the scenario and the facts that we have in this case, it's every bit as likely that the assailant was the deceased as it was if there were three men in
the
apartment.
There was no evidence of that. Maybe hypothetically that's true, but there was no evidence.
There was no evidence other than if you adopt that run them means rob them, that it occurred as Ms. Murphy actually said it occurred. None. All we know is that she moved the gun, she took the blood, her hand was in the blood, she hid the gun, she hid the money, she lied to the police, and when she got caught...
May I? It sure. Sounds like you're saying to us, because of those facts, that they should not have believed her testimony. And you're asking us not to accept that she testified and they believed her testimony. We can't go back and review whether or not she was credible or not. That was the jury's call, wasn't it?
And I agree with that, Your Honor, but the problem with that is when you let the external influences upon the jury, to wit the shotgun, and the implications that it could have been used in the armed robbery, it was found in the closet where he was arrested. That's the connection with the defendant. And as I said, not even the jury bought the connection.
So if we accept your proposition that it was error, there was no prejudice because the jury found him not guilty of that offense.
It is not that offense that I'm worried about. It is the prejudicial effect of putting it all together to help the Commonwealth.
Is it prejudicial when the jury is able to separate it? Since they found him not guilty, possession of a sawed-off shotgun, belief that he possessed a sawed-off shotgun cannot have influenced their decision on the murder verdict.
Oh, it certainly implies that he is a person who would have guns and would be capable of joining others.
It was in a child's bedroom where he was hiding.
Right? All I'm saying to you is, Judge, any mention of a gun when you have a shooting and a dead person with a gun is incredibly prejudicial to the defendant's rights. To deny that is to deny what is obviously going on in the normal person who's a juror.
They found it wasn't. so that he didn't possess it. He's not smeared with that.
Respectfully, Your Honor, I disagree. The shotgun is one of the crucial issues and a mistake of the trial judge joining in this particular thing. And we get further to the point.
Would you say that that's the most crucial issue in your argument?
No. The most crucial issue of my argument is that there's no evidence of an armed robbery or an attempted armed robbery. And that's taking into consideration, sir.
How can you say there's no evidence when there are people, you may not believe them, but there are people who testified that run them means rob them? How can you say there's no evidence?
It's real easy because...
It may not be believable evidence.
Well, and that's the point I'm trying to get at.
But you can't say there's no evidence.
The believability of this is based on the fact that the trial court is helping the government in the venture of convicting the defendant, even at the final request by counsel. When the question comes in about whether or not there's a joint venture here, and does the person, and the defense counsel says to the judge, listen, I want an instruction that even if you believe all of this, you have to tell the jury that my client would have to be aware that one of the joint venturers was actually armed. Now, to the best of my understanding, that's a fair request that would be made by any competent trial counsel. The judge said, I'm not doing that. This is a case where it wasn't the thumb of the judge on the scales of justice. There was far more on the scales of justice than the thumb in this particular case. Nothing about this. My sister keeps arguing in her brief, and it's an admirable attempt. She keeps talking about that the evidence must be viewed in a light most favorable to the Commonwealth. Of course it was viewed in a light most favorable to the Commonwealth. By putting in the shotgun, by the judge saying, I don't know whether I see this armed robbery, but there must be this attempted armed robbery. She was putting more than her thumb on those scales. I agree with you, Judge, that there was testimony. And yes, we can argue over whether there was no viable evidence or whether there was evidence that would suggest this. But the mere sentence, run him, and the fact that we don't even really know who said that, I am not arguing that there was not that testimony. But what I am arguing is the defendant is entitled to a trial where the scales are at least somewhat equal. And in this case, they were not. And we don't even know whether or not, as argued in my brief, whether or not we were convicted on a joint venture theory, whether we were a principal, we don't know whether they adopted it. All we know for sure, we know this absolutely certain, you're right, Your Honor, they did not find that a shotgun in a child's closet, the possession of a shotgun relative to the defendant being found guilty. That's what we know from the verdict. And we don't know anything more. And I would close my argument in suggesting to you that if there was a joint venture, and I realize that this is not a popular argument to make, but members of the capital crimes teams are faced every day with trying cases where we expect a reasonably level playing field. And in this particular case, I tell you that the joint venture was actually a joint venture engaged in by the trial court and the district attorney's office. And I suggest to you that the final fact...
That's a very serious charge to make.
It is, and the final
and
thing...
I wonder whether that's appropriate without some very strong evidence to back that up.
As far as I'm concerned, the government, in its final argument, which I put forth in my brief and complain about, go along with saying that the blood of the person whose DNA was actually found in the apartment, that person had visited the defendant on the night of the murder. Those facts were not in evidence at all. And I admit the defense counsel did not take advantage of stopping and getting a correction of that. But the trial judge actually went on the record and said, I've been listening to this case very, very closely. And what I'm saying to you is, Your Honors, that in this particular case, this is a crucial issue in this particular case. You can't link a person whose DNA in blood is actually found at the crime scene with the defendant in this particular case and then not correct that on the record. It's part and parcel of the problem in this particular case. And the shotgun is mentioned, too. The government took advantage of every advantage that they were given by the trial court. They didn't even make an attempt to avoid it. So what I'm all saying to you is, given the fact that they had a weak case to begin with, admission of certain amounts of this evidence denied the defendant a fair trial. That's what we're arguing in this brief. And the defense counsel made some mistakes. I've enumerated them. I started that. But they are not the primary issue in this matter. I argue to you the primary issue in this matter was that the deck was stacked against the defendant. And the person responsible for that was the trial judge. That is the argument that Mr. Cannon makes through his counsel. Unless there's any other questions, I rest on my brief.
Thank you, Mr. Schubert. Ms. Harlan.
Good morning, Your Honors. May it please the Court, Julia Haller, Special Assistant District Attorney, on behalf of Plymouth County in this matter. First, as Judge Cowan points out, I think it's completely inappropriate for the defendant here to argue that the prosecutor, our second assistant, and now the Honorable Judge Robert Welsh was somehow in cahoots with Justice Giles in this case. There is no evidence of that. What we have here was a very well-tried case by the defendant, the defense attorney, and by the prosecutor. And what the defense attorney had to do was knock down the testimony of Kerry Murphy, because Kerry Murphy, the girlfriend who was almost 9 months pregnant with Mr. Hecker's child, was present. She knew the defendant. He had been in the house before. He had bought drugs from Mr. Hecker there before. She testifies to the jury, and again, it was for, Your Honors are right, it was for the jury to evaluate when the statements were made, why these statements were made, and where ultimately the truth lay in this case.
Ms. Harder, let me ask you this. Was there any evidence that the wounds that caused the death of this victim were caused by a shotgun?
No, it was a handgun injury.
It was a handgun.
Right.
So a shotgun is found someplace else?
Right. It was found in the closet in the room where the defendant, Mr. Cannon, was found. The room, and there was a great deal of testimony that the room was the testimony of young children because of the nature of bedding and the toys.
Assuming that the defendant is carrying the shotgun, which is why I assume that the motion to sever was denied, that he could have been armed with that shotgun.
He could have been armed with it, but also it was the state of the evidence as it existed. The gun was there when he was arrested for this.
No, I understand that, but I'm just trying to think how you link it. To link it to this crime, he must have carried the shotgun with him. In other words, I might have a shotgun in my closet doesn't mean that I murder.
No, but the fact that you have access to weapons is a valid point. If you
access
terms,
to any weapon?
No, firearms. And I believe I argued in this in the Commonwealth versus Salahuddin Ali, of the Ali case, if I can go that far back, where there was a challenge to the fact that one of the defendants went to find a firearm. Well, there was nothing linking it to it, but that was allowed in because it showed that this person did have access to firearms.
In that case, at least as I recall, somebody's going to, there's mm-hmm. evidence that mm-hmm. he went to find a firearm.
Right.
Here, there's no evidence that this defendant was going, but just go with me for a second.
Okay.
At the hearing on the motion to sever, was it the Commonwealth's position from the beginning that the defendant did not have the shotgun, but simply it was indicative that he had access to weapons, or did the Commonwealth argue that he could have had the shotgun?
The Commonwealth, at the time of the killing or at when he was arrested? Which
no, 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 at the time of the killing.
The evidence was
I'm asking you what the Commonwealth
the Commonwealth's
argued.
Position was that he constructively possessed this shotgun when he was arrested.
Okay, so he possesses the shotgun, which means that presumably he doesn't possess the murder weapon.
No, he possesses the shotgun at the time he's arrested, not at the time of the killing.
I'm asking you to focus on the
right
at the time of the motion to sever.
Right.
Or at the time when the if it's different, the Commonwealth attempted to introduce the shotgun. Was it the Commonwealth's position that no, this shotgun was never there? We only want the jury to hear about it to show that this is a man who has a shotgun in his possession? Or was it the Commonwealth's position and or that the defendant could well have carried the shotgun to the apartment in which this killing occurred? I'm not asking you to argue.
Yeah, it's hard to argue that because we only know it from hindsight.
I'm asking you to explain what the Commonwealth's position was.
The Commonwealth's position was that the defendant could have possessed the handgun. That was the shooting as well. Our position was he was the principal, based on the way the evidence came out.
But the Commonwealth never contended that the sawed-off shotgun was used in the robbery.
That there was no evidence presented at trial.
You wanted to use the evidence of the shotgun for consciousness of guilt.
And to show there was a question as to consciousness of guilt as to...
How could you use a shotgun, which is found when the defendant is arrested in another building, as consciousness of guilt?
It's found in the evidence of what happens. You have to consider the whole scene of when the police arrive. The defendant is staying with family, not where he normally stays, at his mother's house, but he's at a cousin's house. His sister, in the afternoon, comes and tells him, the police were all over our house, and they were there. And that 3 hours later, they arrive at this cousin's house in a warrant team to arrest the defendant. When the police knock on the door, the cousin testifies that the police identify themselves. The defendant's standing there with her. By the time she's done and open it, he's gone. He's gone around into another part of the room, and he's gone into the small children's bedroom, and there's evidence that there's a sawed-off shotgun found in there and that the damage that had been done as it was jammed in there appeared fresh. So this was evidence of consciousness of guilt. He knew the police were looking for him.
I understand all of that, the circumstances of the arrest. I'm trying to understand why having a shotgun goes to consciousness of guilt. I mean, the fact that you're trying
the jury could infer that perhaps he changed his mind about not wanting to be arrested, or he was going to.
Wait, excuse me?
That had originally been one of the prosecutors. The thoughts was that perhaps the defendant was going to confront the police with force rather than be arrested. He had been avoiding the police's conduct. But it's also admissible to show that he did have access to guns.
Was there any evidence that he was going to, as far as I can hear, there's absolutely unrebutted evidence that he's doing, unquestioned evidence that he's doing everything that he can to run away from the police?
Right, until he gets down to that last space, which he's basically cornered, he has the gun. And the judges, the jury was given the instruction on constructive possession, and they determined, perhaps beyond a reasonable doubt, but that doesn't mean it wasn't admissible. It can't be extrapolated back.
I'm really having a very hard time understanding on what basis that's admissible.
Do we have cases that say that even when the defendant is found in possession of a weapon that is not the murder weapon, that evidence is admissible?
Sure, yes.
We have many cases that say that.
We do.
Is an example of the same type of evidence.
Right.
That the defendant is found in possession, arguably in possession of a weapon, even though it's not the murder weapon, that evidence is admissible.
And right.
That's the theory on which it was
evidence. And also we're dealing with this on a substantial...
In what circumstances and for what basis?
It's a basis to show that he is a person, he does have... I don't know how to describe it. The firearms, it's admissible to show that he does have access to these.
What's the strongest case that you have for this?
Just off the top of my head, I can only think of my own case, which is Commonwealth versus Ali, in which I say there is testimony that before an armed robbery, a defendant
went to look for weapons, right?
No, he's made arrangements to get a gun, and he brings it back, and a gun is found. Now, there's no evidence that this gun was used. I don't cite Ali in my brief. It's a 1998 case, perhaps. I'm not sure. I think I argued it in 97.
How do you spell Ali?
A-L-I. Yes, yeah. Salahuddin Ali. It's an appeals court opinion.
Oh, I can understand somebody saying you.
But the other standard here, too, is that we're not dealing with this on a level of prejudicial error. This is a substantial likelihood error. And as pointed out, the jurors were able to discriminate in how to use this. They find him...
Well, that's a different issue. The different issue is if you're charged with an offense. The question, what you're saying to me is the mere fact that they found him with a gun can come in whether or, as I understand your argument, and I'm having a hard time as you can tell, whether or not there was a separate indictment for, what was it, possession, I forget.
Possession of a sawed-off shotgun.
Possession.
Right.
You know, what you are suggesting to me, and correct me if I'm misunderstanding you, is that that evidence comes in whether or not there's a separate indictment.
Right, right. And but there's also it was also the discretionary of the discretionary decision of the judge in this matter, because pretrial, you know, it arose from the same set of facts, and certainly the joinder issues. The defendant, you know, hasn't met his burden of showing that it wasn't. Beyond the judge's discretion, it wasn't a judge didn't abuse her discretion. There's the word I'm looking for. I apologize. Didn't abuse her discretion by allowing joinder in what was logically part of the could be seen as logically part of the whole case. The Commonwealth's case of the shooting.
I have to say I have a very hard time understanding that, because you can indict somebody for possessing without a license, I assume, is what was at issue here.
No, it's possession of a sawed-off shotgun, of an illegal weapon in and of itself.
Of an illegal weapon in and of itself. It's hard to see how that's necessarily connected to a murder where, one, that's not the weapon, and two, a claim of the Commonwealth is that this defendant is the principal, i.e. the actual shooter.
It was both the principle of the joint venture.
No, I understand that.
And the evidence
the claim
came out,
is there that this...
Right, it could have been that the evidence could have was also that the other person, the unidentified person, says, run him, run him. And then there's almost immediately the shots, which if there's two people, which is what Kerry Murphy's saying, is you have the unknown person saying, run him, run him. He's obviously speaking to the defendant.
Correct.
And then there's the shot. So the defendant
is most likely the principal, which makes it less likely that he's carrying or has it, that the shotgun, sort of shotgun, has any connection to this murder.
But the case law allows you to show the access to the guns and to show it, we never found the handgun. That's true.
But
it
does. It's not a sort of shotgun.
We know there was at least one gun present. Two guns, if you count Mr. Hecker's, but there was evidence that that was never fired at all.
And that gun was or was not recovered?
Mr. Hecker's was recovered. Right. It had been tested. It was as unfired and had the two bullets in it, as said, and it was not consistent. There also was evidence that Hausen, whose blood was found, somehow there must have been some sort of misadventure, because he ends up bleeding all the way down the stairs. Now, we don't know who he must have been shot or in the way of one of the bullets. We don't know what happened there.
Well, so that evidence seems to exclude Hausen from being one of the shooters. And you argue that the defendant was the shooter, that you contradict something that's in the defendant's brief, that you do argue that the defendant was the shooter.
We argue both, yes.
Yeah. Now, part of it is by eliminating Hausen as a shooter because he got shot. But what about the third man? Why couldn't he have been the shooter? Why wasn't it equally possible for him to be the shooter?
I suppose that this third person is very kind of
amorphous.
There's really no evidence of a third person being present in the apartment, according to Murphy's testimony, because she hears the defendant's voice.
Don't people see three men getting out of the car?
They see three men getting out of the car, but then there's testimony that one person hears two people coming down the stairs. I mean, It could be that this third person was a lookout, exactly, or the person who kept the door open so they wouldn't have any problems coming down and getting out, because there was testimony about the nature of the locks on this door because it was an apartment building. And there was no evidence of the role of the third person. I couldn't really say, well, this third person was a lookout.
There was no evidence in the apartment.
In the apartment, there were two people.
Right.
And we know, and the jury could have found that one was the defendant, absolutely was the defendant.
Well, we know several things. We know there were two people.
Right.
We know that one of them was injured, and that person wasn't the defendant.
And that was not the defendant. That was Hausen, because his blood goes from all the way down.
And do we know, and just be careful how you answer this, do we know that the defendant, that the victim's gun was not used, or do we
absolutely.
Know? We know only that there were new shells in the gun.
There was absolute testimony that it was not fired, that the gun was
had never been
was
fired.
Had not it was an automatic, it had one gun locked and loaded for it was jacketed, it was into the chamber, there was one in the handle, which is the way he kept his gun. None of the
spent casings,
they were all consistent with a 38.
But there was no spent casing in the room.
There were no spent casings. These were the actual projectiles were found in the room, and they were inconsistent with his caliber of weapon, which was a 40 caliber, and these were 38 caliber. And the ballistics expert testified that it was, in his opinion, it was probably a revolver because there was no ejected casings around there. But even
I take it, Ms. Holler, that at the time that the victim leaves the apartment, he's still alive, correct?
The victim?
No.
Had
she left before the victim? Because she, as I recall, and forgive me if I'm getting this wrong, she kept asking whether or not.
Right, when she goes, it's unclear on what they're actually doing to try and resuscitate the defendant at the
That's what I mean.
At the apartment. It's very unclear. There's some testimony that the EMTs arrive, but then there's testimony that nobody's working on him. She thinks he's still alive when she makes her first statement.
Let me rephrase the question. Not what was the medical testimony, but what was her belief at the time that he was...
Her belief was that he was alive and that he was going to survive. I mean, obviously that was her wish, and that was how she was approaching. And she was very candid when she testified, I didn't want to get him in trouble, so I hid the gun. I didn't want to testify that I knew anybody because, you know, these are people that run around with guns. I don't want to be subject to...
Isn't it a fair inference that she didn't know who had shot what, that it's possible, from her point of view, I'm not saying from the evidence, it's possible that... The victim might have shot. The victim might have recovered, and she doesn't know any of this, correct?
The victim might have shot.
She doesn't know at the time what happened, correct? She hears voices and she hears gunshot wounds, right? Put yourself in her position. She doesn't know what the father of her child has done. If she assumes that he is still alive, he might be in very serious trouble if it turns out that he in fact shot one of the...
I don't think it was her thought, and you can get this from her testimony, is that she was concerned only about him possessing a handgun, which can be inferred he didn't have a license for, and the fact that he's selling drugs.
Right.
It was nothing to do with any further assault of them. She was concerned only as to if he would be able to go on his business as usual if everybody, you know, maintains this code of silence and doesn't say what happened. And then it's not until she finds out that he's dead, and she comes back on her own the next morning and tells them, this is what really happened.
I'm back on the question of the propriety of admitting the evidence of the shotgun, which wasn't the weapon used in the murder. Don't we have cases, and I mentioned two of them, Commonwealth versus Tewitt, 393 Mass 801, and Commonwealth versus James, 424 Mass 770, that say that it's proper to admit a gun even if it may not have been the one used in the crime.
And that's the state of the law.
That's the theory under which this evidence of the shotgun, even though it may not have been the one used in the crime.
And the fact that they find him not guilty could be that at that point they find that he isn't in possession of it.
Ms. Holler, let me turn to the prosecutor's closing argument.
Yes, sir.
Was there any evidence other than the evidence that Hausen was the person who was wounded and evidence that that Murphy had seen the defendant in the apartment. Right. Was there any other evidence that Housen and Murphy were together that night?
Housen and the defendant, you mean?
Housen and the defendant were together that night.
No, there's no evidence, and that was a misstatement. He misspoke in that when he said that, that Housen was the person, because there was no evidence that – there was evidence that Housen was one of the people that the defendant always hung out with. And again, that the prosecutor – it's not a guilt. We're not arguing, obviously, a guilt by association, because there is the clear link with Carrie's – Murphy's testimony of seeing him. But and that was a misstatement, but in – the circumstances of the closing argument and the judge's instructions, and even right before the prosecutor makes that statement, he says, and it's your memory that that counts here. So he's even telling them, well, go back and check this yourself. And it was a misstatement. It was not objected to. And certainly under the substantial likelihood test, it does not rise to the level of something that would grant a new trial, given the fact that we have Murphy's eyewitness testimony of seeing the defendant and making eye contact with him for almost 15 seconds and having heard his voice before and then having met him before. And even there was testimony through the defendant's own witnesses that he had this nickname of Nine. Oh, my goodness, I just realize the time. And if there are no further questions, I will submit on my brief on behalf of Plymouth County.
Thank you, Ms.
Thank you.